the what CERL is doing and its collaboration at the Europe-wide level, and ending with a closer look at one of CERL's collaborative projects, Sendari. And the presentations will be followed by a Ligatus and CERL reception back in the green room, which I hope you'll all be able to join us for. There will be wine that's being kindly sponsored for us by Max Proximity. So our first paper today is jointly presented by Per Kuhnhead and Professor Nicholas Pickwood. Nicholas Pickwood, as many of you will know, is the director of the Ligatus Research Centre here at the University of the Arts, London. He's had a distinguished career to date, with highlights that include running his own bookbinding workshop from 1977 to 1989, editing the journal The Paper Conservator, acting as chief conservator at Harvard University Library in the States, teaching book conservation at Columbia University Library School in New York, and running courses across the world on European bookbindings. Besides directing the Ligatus Research Centre, Nicholas is also currently advisor to the National Trust on Book Conservation and project leader for the St. Catherine's Monastery Library Project. The other speaker of the section is Per Kuhnhead, who's based at the University Library of Uppsala in Sweden, where he's currently Strategic Development Manager. He's also been a senior conservator there, and he's currently chair of the IFLA Preservation and Conservation Section. He's an elected member of the Coordinating Committee for CERL. He's currently chairs the CERL Bookbinding Working Group, and he's published widely on conservation and library disasters. So together, Nicholas and Pearl are going to introduce us to the Ligatus Guidelines for Bookbinding and the activities of CERL's Bookbinding Working Group. I think we're starting with that. Thank you.
Excuse me, I have a small cough, and if it has a small outbreak, please excuse me. I wish to start by thanking Nicholas and colleagues for the seminars this morning, and for a very fruitful day with full of meetings and interesting topics. Thank you. And I will be slightly philosophical, I think, in my presentation here about bookbindings and the role of bookbindings. Because they have raised a new interest in the internet era, as they rely so heavily on visual content that can be displayed en masse so successfully on the internet. And if we make a rough comparison between the intellectual content of books and the binding and the material contents of books represented by the binding, this gives us the following. The intellectual content is, of course, manifested by words, and gives us a purpose of the text, be it fact or fiction. Somebody wants to say something that is expressed by words. We also, of course, have some metadata in normal books. We have a title page. We have a date, place, and an author. And there is also an intended audience. Much research is done nowadays on reception of texts. But the material evidence in books is something else. It's evidenced by its materials, its techniques, and also the visual content. And by far, it's very associative. We immediately want to compare one specific aspect of the book with something else, be it a technique or a material. We want to place it in this context, and this very process can be very rewarding in itself, helping us to think, as the philosopher par excellence on materiality, Claude Lévi-Strauss, once put it. He even coined a word for this. He called it in French, bricolage, or tinkering in English. In essence, this means that having the object as at the center of discussion leads us to conclusions we would not otherwise have or make. So in a way, materiality is the close encounters of the third kind in librarianship, adding new dimensions. One example which I have here is a book of a Swedish bookbinder called Johan Berggren. He was active in southern Sweden in the beginning of the 19th century. And he produced a series of diamond-shaped bindings From where did he get his idea about this form? I can't say. But it's a very typical binding of him. And what influenced him? Could it be Irish 18th century bindings? That could be a clue, but I have no real answer to this. But the book poses the question by itself. To find comparative books is important, and we immediately want to ask ourselves, what context does this book belong to? And we start comparing. That's in essence what we do with books, and that's really materiality in books. But of course, to be able to search these books, we need to have the proper search terms in place. The metadata, that's at the core of librarianship, to enter the right metadata for books. And now we have to expand this to book bindings, and that's a tricky business because we all use different standards, and if we search for one term in one search, we might not find the other books because they have been entered with other search terms. And that's something we do in the CERL working group on book bindings. But back to materiality. This is another example. This is a book called Tulipa Hortorum. It's a modern art project, and it's bound by Tini Miura, whom you see here on the picture. It is an enormous book. I've actually seen it. I've carried it. It's heavy. It's done in double elephant folio format. And this is a statement in itself. I mean, talking about materiality and weight and so on, you can't escape from materiality when you deal with a book like this. And we also know that Tini Miura was involved in a facsimile of Audubon's Birds of America, also printed in double elephant folio. And the materiality of the formats says that if you want to make a hugely impressive book, stick to the double elephant folio format. This image shows something else. It's two different pages from two different books. The left one is from the Royal Library in Stockholm, and the right one is from the Vatican. They must have been made in the same workshop. If you look at the borders here, you see the red flowers here, they're the same. The white flower here is also the same, the butterfly here, and so on. So even if the visual content here in the middle differs, the borders were probably made in the same workshop. And again, you want to compare these books and to find the context they were made in. And that's really at the heart of materiality. They were probably both made in Flanders around 1520. And at those days, they were so specialized in different art forms. So you could have a border maker, and you could have an image maker, and you could have a writer making the text, and a bookbinder for the book, etc. This is Rembrandt's Saskia as Flora. It reminds us of the Tulpomania in Amsterdam in the 1630s, with flowers in her hair. And of course, this Tulpomania movement made flowers fashionable in books, and you can immediately find them in books from the 17th century. It's difficult to see on this picture, but clearly these are tulips in 17th century books after the Tulpomania. Here's another example with flowers on books. Became very popular in this century. Techniques are also an important aspect of materiality. I will hand that topic over to Nicholas in just a few seconds. But here we see a book with a 13th century binding underneath a 15th century binding. So in essence, two books, and to be able to say something about these two books and the historical context they were made in, you need to know a lot about their bindings. And if you want to express that on the internet, you need the right vocabulary for doing that. And that is something we are dealing with in the CERL book binding group. This is our remit. And we want to have more bindings on the internet because we believe bindings have a proper place on the internet because they can say such a lot of things about history and about historical contexts. And This is by no means an easy task. I've already said that we have a lot of standards, but we have also have a lot of energy and a lot of new ideas on how to merge standards and send out small pilots to see how this can be done. And with those words, I leave over to you, Nicholas, to get into the structure of books more. Thank you.
Thank you, Bev. A nice example of primary and secondary covers with tongue mitres just flashed past on the screen there. It's a great pleasure for me to be able to be with you all here today and to be able to host CERL at Chelsea. And now to present the three projects which we in Ligatus have been working on for almost as long as Ligatus, if not slightly longer than Ligatus has actually existed. I forget and I'm rather embarrassed by the number of times I have said, well, probably next year. Well, now here we are, it is this year, and we have arrived. And I'm very happy to be in collaboration here with CERL, who have been taking such an interest in our work and encouraged us in it, and shared our desire, as Per has just explained, to see bookbindings given greater prominence in the bibliographical firmament. For me, it certainly has been a source of great frustration for many years, that the study of the history of bookbinding, all bookbinding that is, not just the high-end decorated bindings which are so well known, that it has stood outside the mainstream of bibliographical research and has therefore not been properly exploited for what it can teach us about the book trade and the history of what I call the culture of the book in the broadest sense. Equally, the absence in many rare book library catalogues of any significant information about the bindings to be found in their collections means that access to the bindings for research is next to impossible without access to the stacks, a privilege that is not always available. And just 2 years ago, I was asked to give a lecture at Birmingham for the opening of the great new city library there. I thought I would talk about bindings from their collection, but of course I wasn't allowed in the stacks because of the fire regulations. I hadn't been trained in the use of a gas mask in case of the fire system going off, and so I could not actually refer to any bindings in the collection of Birmingham because I couldn't see any, because they're not in the catalogue. I think a rather good example of just how even the most modern library design can actually militate against this type of research. Equally, it has been an irritant to see that the terms used for the description of bindings when these are given are so often inconsistent, contradictory, and it has to be said sometimes just plain wrong. Central to the whole question of the description of bindings was the absence of the comprehensive terminology that would allow consistent and, where required, detailed descriptions to be made. And this was a point frequently raised in any discussion on the inclusion of catalogue entries of binding descriptions. We'd love to do it, but we can't. There isn't a terminology. Other glossaries have, of course, existed and do exist and are very useful, most notably the Library of Congress Dictionary of Bookbinding and the Conservation of Books of 1982. But this invaluable work was somewhat circumscribed by two things: its reliance on already published work, leading to a heavy preponderance of terms relating to the book trade in the 19th and 20th centuries, where the bulk of the published material comes from, but which does not always accommodate the needs of describing earlier bindings, because simply there are features in the earlier bindings that do not appear in this literature. And its alphabetical arrangement is the second difficulty it faces. It's a printed book, which means that we have to know a term before we can look it up, and this is clearly problematic. An enormous advance was made in 1992 by the publication of Knape and Binding, the work of three authors, Janos Jemai, Kees Hirip, and Peter Gumbert, sadly only the last of whom is still with us, both Kees and Janos died last year. They abandoned a strictly alphabetical arrangement of terms in favor of a thematic approach and gave the terms relevant to each stage, with brief descriptions and, most importantly, a large number of clear and informative drawings. This allowed the user to explore the content of the book by reducing to more manageable limits the parts of the text that might need to be looked through to find a term for a component or feature of a binding, while the drawings could also be used very usefully as a finding aid to help locate the relevant term. You simply scan the images and find what you were interested in, then you could find the term. The book did inevitably suffer from some drawbacks. One, for the Anglophone reader, was that it was compiled in Dutch with very limited and not necessarily always correct equivalent terms in English. but more importantly, that it was printed, which not only therefore made the inevitably necessary additions and corrections dependent on a second edition, which of course now is unlikely ever to happen, but also placed the content within a physical straitjacket, the printed page, with a predetermined order and a limited capacity for cross-referencing. At Ligatus, we therefore made an early decision in compiling what started out as a glossary based on our work at St. Catherine's Monastery on Mount Sinai to work electronically and to benefit from the flexibility that this offered us, both in arranging and accessing our material, but also in allowing us in the future to correct, improve, and expand our material in the light of the comments and criticisms that we will welcome from its users. This was made possible by the work of my colleague Thanasis Velios, who made a reality what I, with my very limited IT skills, could only dream of, and has created the architecture of the thesaurus, which I, with a great deal of help from several people who are here today also, Maria Aguirre, Aurelie Martin, and Alberto Campagnolo, and of course George Boudalis from Thessaloniki, as well as the many existing thesauri that we have used, and the advice from our international advisory groups, have filled this architecture that we have filled, as it were, with the relevant furniture, fixtures and fittings. The structure of the thesaurus is based on the Simple Knowledge Organization System, SCOS, which I reel off with great confidence, but I had never heard of until I met Thanasis, and in which, most importantly, we define concepts, not words, which allows us to avoid the problems common to all alphabetical thesauri, where the structure of the thesis is based on the term, when, as we all know, different people have different terms for the same concept, as, of course, do different languages. We have, of course, supplied a term for each concept, but we have also, where relevant, listed alternative terms that have also been attached to such concepts. So you can search by whichever term you wish and you will find the same concept. If in the future one of the alternative terms becomes clearly preferred by our users, then it can be substituted for the chosen term without disturbing the structure of the thesaurus. Where we discover additional terms that have been used, we can simply add them to the existing alternative terms. And this, of course, works with other languages as well. We can use the same structure in another language without disturbing the structure at all. We're keen to welcome foreign language contributions, of course, and indeed have a student from Palermo starting work this November. I'm not sure she's quite aware of what she's taking on, but she will be beginning the translation of the scope notes into Italian and seeking to find Italian equivalents for as many of the terms as possible. SCOS is wonderful for me because it allows us to avoid the endless wrangling over terms for generally agreed concepts that has bedeviled so much discussion of the thesauri in the past. I think people get very possessive about terms and they don't want to see their term lose out to another person's term. I've been free of this. I am term free. I can take whatever term anybody wants, so long as it's attached to the right concept, we have the meaning, and that is what matters. And we want to include as many historical terms as will come out of the older literature as possible, so that we can make this as comprehensive as we can. And all of these can be accessed by a simple word search, and that is really important. As we have a high proportion of concepts for which there were no existing terms, we have also had to develop new terms. But SCOS allows us to do this without recourse to elaborate committee-based discussions wrangling over the exact term, but by attaching our label to the scope note on the understanding that if a better term emerges in the future, it can be used instead without in any way altering the structure. So we put a label on the definition. If a better label emerges from discussion, we can change that over. By these means, we hope to restore some terms, in fact, to their original meanings. For example, the terms pasteboard and millboard, which have been used indiscriminately for so long, now have new labels, couch laminate board and paste laminate board, but retain the original terms as alternative terms attached to their specific meanings. In time, I hope these words can be restored to their role as the preferred terms. By the same token, we have removed the term yap edges for the feature it has been used inaccurately to identify for so long, and given it what is admittedly a very clumsy term, four-edge cover extensions, the best we could come up with at the time, and we haven't come across a better one yet. When we or somebody else comes up with a better, shorter, more elegant term, we can retire our temporary label and bring in the new one, which I hope will be soon, because I find that label very tiresome indeed. But it is what they are, four-edge cover extensions, which is the one thing that the yap edge actually isn't, which is makes it frustrating. It has the name attached to it. Thanasis also had to wean me off my very amateur tendency in my own homemade database, to build overlong compound terms in very long lists in favor of small groups of single concepts, which can then be brought together to create descriptions. A description, therefore, of the sewing supports on this late 15th century Italian binding can be built up from the separate single concepts, such as pink stained, alum tored, split strap, double sewing supports. That is what you see on the binding in front of you. Very typically Italian materials and very limited in date range. So an extremely useful combination of terms that tells us pretty much exactly where this binding is coming from in Europe. But each of these terms can also be used in combination with other single concepts to describe other types of sewing support. So double supports are common all over Europe. They will have different materials, different formation, and so on. Concepts are also organized from the more general ones, the broader concepts, to the more specific ones, the narrower concepts. A narrow concept should always describe a concept which is included in the broader concept. For example, adzes is a narrow concept of tools and equipment because all adzes are tools. Wherever possible, we have matched our concepts with the concepts from the Getty Art and Architecture Thesaurus, and it is our intention, and we have discussed this with Getty, to submit our concepts to the AAT, where corresponding terms do not exist in their thesaurus. We have fiddled around with some of their definitions from time to time because they're not really too binding related always. This hierarchical structure will allow the user to find terms for binding components or features that they do not know the name of by working from the broader to the narrower concepts. So if you wanted to know how you might describe a particular type of sewing support just observed on a German binding of circa 1500, you could click on the top term, objects in the hierarchy. Then on components, because it's a component we want to find, scroll down the list of components until you get to supported structure components, which will take you to sewing supports. Once there, sewing supports by formation, because we can see how they're made and we want to know what they are. And that takes you to reverse twist supports, which may still be a puzzle to you. But it may be the answer to that strange double-chord sewing support in which the two elements are twisted in opposite directions. Click on the label and the scope note will appear. Not yet the picture, I'm afraid to say, but give us a little more time and it will be comprehensively illustrated. And there you can see the reverse twist and the description, S-twist on one side, Z-twist on the other, particularly typical southern German type of sewing support. If you start from the other end, with the term first, with the scope note, you'll find the last part of the hierarchy, which will let you know where this concept came from within the hierarchy of terms. The thesaurus can, of course, be used alphabetically, and the list you can see on the right will also show you any alternative terms that we have identified for the same concept. And a keyword search will also bring up the same material. Here you can see the definition. We have a stationary bindings, the three alternative labels, and its place within the hierarchy. And here is the keyword search, which is what actually the window you arrive at when you open the website. You're immediately asked, have you got a term you want to put in? And then you'll find out whether we have it in the thesaurus. If we don't, let us know. The thesaurus is also designed to be used as part of a documentation system, and for this reason, recognizing the value of the CDOC CRM in the documentation of cultural heritage, we've chosen our top concepts, object was one of them, to match the CDOC CRM entities so that their narrower concept hierarchies can be used in a documentation system. However, it is not necessary to use a CRM compatible documentation system to make use of what we're doing. By these means, we hope that we've created a resource that will allow access in the most flexible but also logical and intuitive way possible, allowing users with greater or lesser experience to get out of it what they may need. Our primary users will not, I hope, be limited to binding historians, but will include rare book catalogers, conservators, researchers who use early books in their research, and dealers in rare books, who probably describe more bindings than all the other users put together, but who, utilizing a variety of traditional, often very personal vocabularies, are probably more inconsistent and, shall we say, inventive, but also more influential than the others. Many people read booksellers' catalogues and learn their bookbinding descriptions from them and will learn some very odd things from time to time. If we can encourage a more consistent approach with this thesaurus, I will consider it a success. With almost 1,400 terms listed, it is, of course, not complete. I would say that for the work I do, this is actually relatively superficial, but we don't want to overwhelm people at the beginning. And as the research in the field continues, it will probably never will be actually complete. We are always discovering more things. And despite our best endeavors, there will be lacunae. And I have to say, given my ability of typing, a number of typos. But with your help and the help of a wider audience that we hope exists beyond these walls, we can fill those holes and expand the scope of the thesaurus to accommodate discoveries either missed or yet to be discovered. And I will do what I can by the titles. I should add that this work has been guided by an international group of European book specialists who have met here on a number of occasions and have also advised us on the next project that I want to talk about. In the time left over from creating the thesaurus, we've also been working on two other projects which will soon be coming to fruition. The first of which is a book to be published with Ashgate, all being well, in September of this year, with the title Coming to Terms, Guidelines for the Description of Historical Bookbindings. This is intended to be used alongside the thesaurus and to encourage anyone interested to go perhaps a little further into the description of a binding than they might have thought they were either able or indeed wanted to do. This becomes particularly relevant for books which have little or no decoration, where the structure and materials are all there is to describe, and where being able to distinguish, for instance, between bindings with long stitch, tacketed, and external sewing supports may well give the clues as to where and when the bindings were made. The ones at the top have to be French. The one in the middle has to be German. The one at the bottom is also German. And these, once you become more familiar with the bindings, obviously, become more obvious. At 122,000 words, more or less, over 550 pages, with 455 drawings, and we hope 64 pages of colour illustration, the book may appear rather dauntingly long, but it is designed to be dipped into as needed and not read from end to end unless you are a seriously insomniac patient. In the hopes of allowing a more selective use of the book, the text is presented at three different levels, as designed by Jake Hopwood of the Camberwell Press. There is a basic level of text, printed in a typeface called Saga with serifs, which gives information that might be thought necessary for any comprehensive description of a binding. You'll notice that some words are given in italics, and these are used throughout the text to indicate words that you will find in the online thesaurus. So if it's in italics, it's in the thesaurus. For anyone inclined to go a little further into a description, you have to abandon your serifs and march into Saga Sans, which offers more detailed guidance, again, using italics to identify words in the thesaurus. But if you just want the base level, as it were, stick to the serifs and it will take you through a reduced version of the text. If you want to go further, look at the sans serif body of text. The final body of text is printed within what I'm told is called a strike, that is to say, a frame, and gives us warning of something that needs to be looked out for in order to avoid mistakes. These happen all the way through the book. Things that look like one thing but are in fact something else altogether. All the paragraphs are numbered for ease of cross-reference as well, and the text is extensively illustrated with drawings by the illustrator Peter Rhodes, who has had a crash course in the history of bookbinding in the course of doing this. And at the end there will be sections of colour plates with photographs of decorated papers to illustrate Appendix 2, written by Aurélie Martin, as well as detailed photographs of different animal skins that have been used to cover books in Appendix 1. Which tries to inject a little bit of reality into the description of the skins used to cover books and remove perhaps some of the mythical deer that have been used to cover books in the literature for so long. The book is arranged in the order in which I believe it is best to describe bindings, which is in the order in which they were bound, starting with the end leaves and finishing with the fastenings and furniture, very much in the same way that Knape and Binding was organized. This means that it should be possible to go straight to the particular section that may be required. There will, in addition, be an alphabetical index and also a hierarchical index that should allow the user to find the particular paragraph they may be looking for. All of these will have page references on them when we have the page numbers completed, but you can look down this list very quickly to find that part of the structure that may be of relevance to you at whatever level within the hierarchy seems useful to you. My hope is that this book will encourage people who handle early bindings to look a little more closely at them and find the features which will allow that catch-all term, old parchment binding, to be broken down into the many different structures that can be included under that name and allow them to be given at least a country of origin, with all the indications of where and when the books were being sold and read that that provides. Some users may be disappointed to find that some much-used traditional terms are not included, but this is usually because they lack sufficient precision. An example would be calf binding, a term which does not define a type of binding at all, but simply gives a very general indication of a covering material, without even defining whether the calf is tanned, alum tored, or turned into parchment. It is usually taken to mean tanned calf covered binding, and that is the combination of concepts that we recommend for that level of description, not calf binding, which really is essentially meaningless. The guidelines will be published in print form first in September, as we hope, and you can see some specimen copies of parts of the text in the reception room later on this afternoon. But after perhaps 2 years, we also plan to publish it online with the additions, corrections, and amendments that we hope to receive from its users in the meantime. The third project, which we are announcing today, concerns decorated paper. And this project started with an idea about how it might be possible to adapt the way in which watermark identification is carried out to allow decorated papers to be identified visually without having to rely on either written descriptions of such papers, which are almost impossible to understand, in my experience, or on having to describe them, which is next to impossible for all but the most specialized decorated paper historians, amongst whom we do not number ourselves. And this work has been very largely carried out by Aurélie Martin, and this website we hope will be online and accessible within a relatively short time, a matter of months if not weeks. The basic idea, therefore, was to build a resource based on visual images that will offer a collection of these images of decorated papers arranged in a way that will assist people in the location, identification, and recording of papers that they have found in books, and which are easily retrievable and machine searchable. By being digital and online, it can grow with full-color images without limitations on space and cost of reproduction. Using a similar approach to the way in which collections of watermarks are arranged, the database will hold a series of images of decorated papers organized hierarchically in which users can find and compare the papers they may want to identify and describe. Each paper is given a unique reference in the database, which can be used to indicate an exact or close match, just as you might with a watermark book, or use the descriptions we have provided as a guide to be used elsewhere. To allow categorization, indexing, and keyword searching retrieval in the database, the images are accompanied by concepts that are based on the existing literature, which has involved trying to solve some surprisingly knotty terminological issues, as terms have historically been used all too often with little consistency and precision. You will be surprised how many things the word marbled is used to describe, including slices of beef, as it comes to it. And as with the thesaurus, are arranged on the SCOS standard. The adaptation of the existing classification of decorated papers to SCOS has been completed in discussion with the Arbeitskreis Bund Papier, a group of specialists in decorated paper who meet annually in Leipzig, and who have been enormously generous with their help and guidance in this project. And they've helped us to redefine the various concepts and manufacturing techniques. And I think, in return, we have been able to help them in actually organizing some of their concepts into more logical construction. So it's been a very fruitful collaboration indeed. The terminology used in the decorated paper website to describe or tag the papers in order to retrieve them and organize them is one also presented in the main thesaurus of bookbinding terms, so they will read across from one to the other. And we use SCOS for this thesaurus, as this structural model provides a solution to two very common terminological issues. The use of multiple terms to define one concept, as common in decorated paper as in binding generally, and the problem of compound terms comprising multiple concepts. It has interesting features such as allowing for multiple terms to be associated with the same concept, as I've described, as well as adding terms in different languages. And also, as I've explained before, this flexible model liberates the terminological debate from the necessity of having to choose one term over another in one or different languages. And in the decorated paper world, this is a real problem. In addition to photographs and reference number, each paper is defined according to the manufacturing techniques, main type of decoration, the patterns, the tools, the decorative format and colors, again using the SCOS standards, but also basic bibliographical information about the book in or on which the paper is found. That's gone the wrong direction. Yes. Any date, number, location or name printed on the paper that has survived will be transcribed, as they constitute essential historical evidence of the manufacture of the paper. In addition, the type of decoration applied to the edges of the book block will also be specified wherever this is the same as that of the decorated paper used for the end leaves or covers, as this indicates that the manufacture of the paper and the binding of the book must have taken place in the same place and were the work possibly of a single craftsman. The first page is the search page, displaying all the images held in the database. It's not yet fully populated, obviously. And above the images are displayed a number of search fields that can be used to filter the collection of images to select only the type of paper that you are interested in. There are different fields, such as the technique used to produce the paper, the type of decoration, block printed, brocade paper, etc., but also the manufacture of the paper, handmade or Western, or the decorative materials, for instance, paste colours, that were used to make the papers. Other filters will be added later, such as the colours, the features of the tools used, for instance, the negative-positive cut of a metal plate for a brocade paper, or bibliographic information about the books, especially the date and place of publication. Because we want, as this database grows, for it to be used for research purposes. Because one of the questions I don't think anybody can necessarily answer is, when were these papers used and where were they used? And as we collect the bibliographical information, we should get indications of that. The date ranges will become clearer and possible concentrations within certain parts of Europe where the books were published. You can select your search term from one of the drop-down menus, and thumbnail images will appear to help identify the type of decoration. Now, there are many more available now, and will be certainly in the future. For guidance as to which term should be used, you can go to the visual glossaries page, in which all the terms used to describe the papers held in the database are listed with their definitions, and a few images of papers considered to be typical examples of the type of decoration or technique used. If you select one material, in this case the brocade paper, the page will display the papers held in the database that are decorated in that precise way. So you can work your way through the database to try to locate the nearest match to the paper you may wish to describe. Once set up, and this is very important, this resource will be open to submissions from a user group to expand the range and specificity of the examples held in the database. And we encourage anyone using the database to submit photographs of the papers that they find. General guidelines and recommendations on photography can be accessed on the website to comply with some minimal quality standards and help with the reproduction process. After being reviewed, the images will be indexed and uploaded onto the website with the required credits, provenance, and some basic bibliographical information. And we would be happy to offer space on the website to any user who might lack the storage capacity or an organized structure who wish to host their own collections of images of decorated papers. And therefore allow them to be used for the wider benefit of all interested parties. This is because the larger the number of images we can collect, the more useful the resource will be, providing also potential material, as I've said, for research into the history of decorated paper in general. It is our hope to initiate the creation of a user group that will use the resource as a place for discussion also about decorated papers. It's a field which is highly specialized, but which a lot of people see. Everybody handling old books sees decorated papers. And they say, oh, what a beautiful paper, and pass on to the next thing, because it's not that easy to access more information. And the database is designed to allow anyone visiting the website to post comments or start discussions on specific papers or definitions, or on a topic not necessarily related to an example of paper yet held in the database. Users will also find other resources available on the website, such as a bibliography of works about decorative papers. The resource therefore offers a platform to host examples of decorated papers and allow anyone willing to create their own digital resource to use the classification system developed in this particular project. With its various possibilities, we hope that the project will become a useful tool not only for identification, but also an interesting resource for research into the history of these papers and the history of bookbinding in general. Again, the more examples we can accumulate, the more interesting it will be. The success of all these projects will therefore depend to a greater or lesser extent on the contributions that we receive from their users, as the number of books involved and the sheer variety of techniques of both binding and decorating paper lie far beyond the reach of one small research centre. We are all here, all of us, all three of us, so we need help, and we look to the audience here and outside for that help, I hope. But we do hope, however, that you'll find what we've done useful and will let us know how we can improve and extend these resources. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nicholas. We're slightly running over, so I suggest we keep questions until the wine reception, when both Pat and Nicholas will be there to talk to you. So our next speaker is Marion Lefferts, who you saw a moment ago. Marion is the Executive Manager of the Consortium of European Research Libraries. And before coming to CERL, she worked on the illustrated Incunabulum short title catalogue, which is a fish series, for those of you who know it, which reproduces 15th century printed books. And she also works at the International Medieval Institute at the University of Leeds. And today, Marion's going to talk about CERL and its European collaboration.
If somebody can help me find the PowerPoint, that would be great. This was the time when we didn't have many electronic resources, and it was very hard to get to articles in journals, so we created a bibliography on those articles. And after that, I moved to what was then called the Illustrated Ink and Album Short Title Catalogue, just off the reading room in the British Museum, very exciting place to work. It was published by Primary Source Media in Reading. Since then it's become Gale, and now it's with Cengage. And this is where Dr. Lotte Hellinga, the first company secretary of CERL, found me and suggested that I might like to apply for a job at CERL. The rest is history, as they say. So, fingers in pies. Yes, no worries, you haven't ended up in some sort of company program. I'm not going to do a Jamie Oliver on you. But in this presentation, I would like to take you on a tour d'horizon of CERL as an organization, of its activities, and very much about how you can engage with us and how we would like to engage with the community. CERL is a membership organization that has immediate implications on the funding. We do not get government funding or subsidies. Our expenditure is largely covered by membership fees. And although these days we also have some EU funding. Our membership structure allows libraries to join as a single member, and then they have their own representation on meetings and committees, and they have a full vote. But they can also form groups and together have one vote in the CERL annual general meeting. And how the group distributes the cost of membership is entirely up to them. One member can be responsible for the entire fee, which remains the same, or they can split the bill between them. We currently have 257 members in 22 European countries and one member in the United States. That's quite an expansion on the early days, back in the 1980s and 1990s, when the British Library, the Bibliothèque Nationale de France, and the Bayerische Staatsbibliothek in München first discussed the notion of a pan-European organisation to support electronic cataloguing of early printed materials. The latest groups that are now splitting the bill that have joined are from the Netherlands, Sweden and Norway. And there's a flurry of activity in the United States, which we hope will culminate in the formation of a group very soon. Our audience. So last year we celebrated the 20th anniversary of CERL. We can actually take many years and celebrate several times, which we will do. But last year was the formal birth of the company, limited by guarantee. And in those 20 years, not only the number of CERL members has increased, so has our portfolio of services and tools that CERL offers its members. This Venn diagram here shows our CERL current activities, several of which I will describe in more detail in a minute. Initially, the idea was that a CERL database would support librarians in their work in the cataloguing department and on the reference desk. But soon it became clear that this database was also very useful for and much appreciated by scholars in a wide range of humanities disciplines. Whereas initially we focused on materials in the hand press book database, in that database we later added manuscripts, both medieval and modern manuscripts to our remit, and in the Sundari project we are also working with archival materials. That means that we are not only offering tools and services that are of interest to rare books and manuscripts librarians, but also to booksellers and scholars and archivists, all of whom are around the Venn diagram. In order to reach this very extensive and extended community of interest, we post all our news on the CERL website, which is there, www.cerl.org. And in addition, we have a presence on LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, and every 6 months we publish a CERL newsletter. If you are on the CERL dissemination list, and 1,000 of our colleagues already are, you will be informed when the next issue is out, is posted on our website or sent to you electronically. That dissemination list that I just mentioned isn't just for the publication of our own CERL news, but it is. We find that the mailing list is also very popular with our members, who use it as a channel for informing the community of their latest news, of relevant publications and the beautiful exhibitions that they host. You may have seen our vibrantly coloured leaflets. I've brought the manuscript one here. CERL staff uses it at conferences and seminars, but we are making it available to our members as well, who can use the leaflets in their reading rooms. And occasionally we prepare little presents, like the notebooks at the top of the page there, and I've already seen some of you with our new button. I couldn't find mine, sorry. So let's look at some of our services that we have created over the years. This is our Heritage of the Printed Book database. It was first made available to our members in 1997, and I think it was around 6 or 7 databases with 600,000, 700,000 records. The database at the moment contains a steadily growing number of bibliographical descriptions for early printed books, and that date range is around 1450, start of the printing period, and then the end of the hand press period, and that's sort of from 1830 and in some countries 1850 or a bit later. The HPB database is a valuable resource for studying the transmission and dissemination of texts in print. When was a text first published, and in which country, and when was it translated? Did it see very many reprints and editions, and to which countries did it spread? How many copies of these editions still survive today, and in which collections, or who were the previous owners? Those are all sorts of questions that you can answer by looking at the HPB. The HPB is hosted by VZG, which is the Verbundzentrale GBV in Göttingen. And through their interface, which is actually developed by OCLC, we can offer many specialist indexes, which allow you to search on imprint data, on provenance data, the size of the book, is it a quarto or a folio, fingerprints, references, as well as, of course, author and title and year, our standard indexes. As more and more books are being digitized over the years, more and more of our HPB records offer direct access to those digital copies. At the bottom of the page, I have not duplicated Eurovision Song Contest. This is our portfolio of libraries and countries that have contributed. There are 21 flags. And in those 21 countries, there are 42 libraries or library consortia which have contributed to the database. And we currently have 6 million records. Just in case you can't see, 6 million records, and more is coming. Members and non-members alike may offer their catalogues for inclusion in the HPB. Bringing data together brings together a wealth of knowledge about our shared European heritage and exposes the close ties and cultural connections that exist between our countries and our nations. The HPB is made up of data sets with different cataloguing practices and cataloguing languages, and that's causing all sorts of interesting problems. In particular, there's much variation in recording the names of authors and of printers' names and of places. The CERL Thesaurus was developed to bring all these variants together and to support searching on the HPB, which it does very successfully indeed. The basis of the CERL Thesaurus was the German National Name Authorities file, which is now part of the Gemeinsame Normdatei. And various CERL member authority files were contributed, not just for names, but also for place names. And most recently, the French National Authority file has been included. While this is an achievement in itself, the success of the CERL Thesaurus, and it is a success, it's actually clocking up about 20,000 searches per month, just as a standalone database. So the success of the database lies in the enhancements of the data sets that have been executed by the data conversion group in Göttingen, which hosts the CERL Thesaurus, and on the bottom left you see a picture of Alex Janke, who is our main man in that office. The team in Göttingen have enriched the original thesaurus data by linking the CERL Thesaurus to a large number of external resources, and you see some logos here. These include general resources that are frequently used for this purpose, and that includes Wikipedia, DBpedia, Getty's GeoNames, the location of places on Google Maps, Europeana, and also the VF, the authority file for names. In addition, the CERL Thesaurus links to more specialist resources that are relevant to our community, and that includes printers' devices brought together in Italy. There's a very nice database called Marte. The printers' devices brought together in Spain, and there is a large data set from the Complutense in Madrid, which is the same thing, Spain, at the University of Complutense in Madrid. We also link to digitized versions of printer devices, which we have digitized from Caro, from Renoir, and from Vindel. And we include information about paper mills, and that was taken from the Bernstein Watermarks project. More recently, the provenance element in the CERL Thesaurus has been strengthened with the inclusion of the English book owners in Britain, which was compiled by Meg Ford at Christie's, and the base provenance des livres anciens of the Bibliothèque Municipale de Lyon. Paul Needham has shared his very extensive Index Possessorum Incunabulorum with CERL, and we are exploring ways of structuring this information, which is currently in a kind of Word file, and structure it in such a way that it can be reused in a database environment. More and more researchers, rather than creating their own ontologies and taxonomies and thesauri, actually find their way to the CERL Thesaurus and reuse the data in their own projects. And we are very keen on this, and we support it by making sure that the CERL Thesaurus is freely available via SRU and as linked open data. And it may be reused in an open license, which is akin to CC BY, and that's the IOOI logo that you see there on the far left. You may know of a database, or you may host them yourself, which should be integrated or linked to from CERL Thesaurus and vice versa. Suggestions and invitations are always very welcome. In the last 5, maybe 10 years, we see more and more explicit emphasis on narrating the story of the book as an item, as an object. We are more and more interested in who owned the book, where did he buy it, for how much, who gave it to him, in which context was the book read, studied, annotated, or collected. This is not new. The BMC catalogue is full of this type of information. But what is perhaps different is that the book historian is trying to discover national and international trends and patterns on the basis of a more extensive set of information. And in this case, researchers are helped enormously if all that provenance information is brought together conveniently in one place and hopefully in the same similar data structure. As with the rise of electronic catalogues in the 1980s and 1990s that we saw culminating in the HBB, and the importance of thesauri for enriching the linked open data network for cultural heritage that is slowly emerging, and it can't come soon enough, CERL is very aware alive to this heightened interest in provenance information. And we have set up a provenance working group, which is led by Marike van Delft of the Koninklijke Bibliotheek, and you see her picture there in the middle. She's working in the National Library of the Netherlands. That group monitors trends and developments, actively engages with the community, and advises the CERL Coordinating Committee on what CERL can do in this field. Currently, CERL is actively engaged in gathering provenance information in the Material Evidence in Incunable database, which I will tell you about in a minute. We are also ensuring integrated access to these resources, for example, through the HPB, the CERL Thesaurus, MEI, and some standalone databases like the Early Book Owners and the IPI database. And finally, we very actively engage in the lively discussions on evolving standards for recording this information in catalogues. There are very many European groups discussing how we best shape the recording of provenance information in our catalogues and in our catalogue standards. From this slide, you can see the provenance may take many forms. You can have bindings with coats of arms or ex libris, a book plate, again, possibly with a coat of arms or another image relevant to the owner. There may be owner's marks or annotations, very small, just below Malika, book prices. And there are old shelf marks on some of these books as well. They're not always very easy to decipher. As a farewell present to our second company, Dr. David Shaw, the colleagues in Göttingen developed the Can You Help facility on the website. On this, it's in the middle of this picture. Here you can post questions, and an active community of researchers is always very keen to help you to answer these queries and to display their knowledge of a particular topic. When a former owner has finally been identified, we add that information to the CERL thesaurus. This is the MEI database that I mentioned before. MEI stands for Material Evidence in Incunabula, and this database was initiated by our current CERL secretary, Dr. Christina Dondi, and she started it with funds from the British Academy, granted to her and Nigel Palmer of Oxford, and further development is being funded by a 5-year ERC consolidator grant, and takes place in the 15th century book trade project, also at Oxford. The MEI database records all valuable clues for provenance and, where possible, adds geographical and chronological information in order to meet the MEI aim of providing a physical representation of the circulation of books throughout centuries, from place of production to their present locations and all the intermediate stages. The database is linked to the Incunabula Short Title Catalogue from the British Library, from which it derives the bibliographical records, and then the combination in MEI, this is combined with a search of the provenance information recorded by various partners in the project. In addition to this information, MEI records extensive additional details. For example, the explicit ownership notes are marked. Are they private or were they institutional? Are they religious or were they lay? Made by a woman or a man? And what was the profession of the annotator at the time of writing? Manuscript notes are classified according to their frequency and their type. You can have corrections, completions, supplements, extraction of keywords, collation, translation, maybe something to help you to understand the structure of the text, comments, censorship, the deictic, pointing hands, drawings, corrections, and sometimes lecture notes. Where there are personal and institutional names of ownership, they are linked to the CERL thesaurus of provenance names, and further biographical information, where did he work, when was he born, when did he die, are all recorded in the CERL thesaurus. Provenance locations are linked to the CERL thesaurus of place names, and we add geo-coordinates and map locations. We already saw the picture of Alex Janke in the CERL thesaurus, where he also plays a pivotal role in developing this one, and the database is much enhanced in the 15th century book trade project. In January 2015, 4,596 editions in 9,100 copies had been catalogued, so they're making good progress, although 28,000 is still on the horizon. The project funds extensive book-in-hand cataloguing, also at the British Library, and it is working on integrating existing provenance data, because there are provenance records about, but they aren't always necessarily integrated into a library's catalogue. Or they aren't always electronically available. In the case of Bot Inc., we're taking the 5,000 provenance entries that are available and trying to slot them into the MEI database. More on the MEI and book trade. That's the next sentence. In addition to that, colleagues in Oxford are working on the visual representation of this data. So how can we visualize the spread of book ownership across Europe And more of that is in the workshop of the LIBE Forum for Digital Cultural Heritage, which is taking place tomorrow morning in Senate House. They are also looking in the project on creating resources for text available through incunables, and they're trying to build up a database that records everything that was published in an incunable, so every text. All libraries, including present companies, you're all warmly invited to add your provenance information to this European resource and share that information. Manuscripts. LIBE, CERL has a close working relationship with LIBE in the digital forum, in the cultural forum that I just mentioned. One of the groups in LIBE was the Manuscript Experts Group, and they moved to CERL as an umbrella organisation. And the membership, the manuscript librarians are very much looking into curating manuscripts, what you do to care for them, what you do to give access to them, and how do you collaborate on the European level in these issues. There's a link between that manuscript expert group through the manuscript working group, which is part of the Consortium of European Research Libraries and chaired by Frau Jutta Weber in Berlin. And what it covers is all sorts of manuscripts. So here you see Hebrew. You see Marjorie Kemp, who was recently in the news with a find in the Polish archive. Well, actually, it may be true that she did take all these travels to the Holy Land and went on pilgrimage, and it wasn't an armchair philosophy. Very early manuscript, but also letters by Freud in this case, and manuscripts with with beautiful illustrations like the Swedenmaster, but you can also have very plain manuscripts. So the whole range, early, modern, medieval letters, archival material is covered. Much of that material is made available in the CERL portal for manuscripts and early printed books, and it's hosted at the University of Uppsala in the Electronic Publishing Center. It contains Spanish, the Manus database, Digital Scriptorium in the United States, Manuscriptorium in Eastern Europe, in Prague in this case, but also it contains descriptions of early printed books. So what we very much wanted to do in the CERL portal was to give access to both our manuscript heritage and our early printed heritage side by side and break down that barrier between them, which traditionally often existed. And of course our own HPB database and the English short title catalogue and too small for me to be in the Spanish database. And IROM. IROM is an interesting case. It actually records where we have digital surrogates for microfilm or these days also digitized materials. And we think that's an important resource for this particular CERL portal as well to contain. Oops. These are not the chairman of our security working group. These are, in fact, Edward Forbes Smiley III and Farhad Hakimzadeh. They are both convicted book thieves. And this is precisely what we try to prevent from happening in the security network. The security network is set up as a safe environment for members to exchange information on thefts and patterns of thefts and to work closely together on methods of detection and prevention. That way, we can make life more difficult and more risky for thieves who want to steal from our collections, and we can protect our collections better. These are the words of our chairman of the CERL Security Network Group, Christian Jensen of the British Library. Membership of the working group is restricted to CERL members on nomination of the member library, but the security working group conferences and workshops are normally open to all, as is the information that we record on the website. The security mailing list is hosted by INIST here at the bottom, the organisation of our chairman, our treasurer, Raymond Berin. The institutions may nominate one member of staff, and that's typically the head of security or equivalent, and they are put to the CERL security mailing list. And the mailing list is a secure environment where you can exchange information about somebody who's visited your institution that you have suspicions about, or alert other members about books that are missing from your collections, and we had a list only last week from one of the larger institutions in Europe. Over the years, there have been numerous examples of the same thief targeting libraries and archives across Europe, and the security network mailing list functions as an early warning sign, we hope. And the aim is that through the exchange of information and openness in this respect, let's inform the community of what is going on in our institutions. And we hope that reduces the time frame during which thieves can go ahead unhindered. So, and you will have noticed that I've skipped the working group on bookbinding. They've already had so much interest and so much airtime that I didn't do a slide on them. But that's part of the CERL makeup as well. In addition to these working groups, we organise lots of seminars on various topics. We had topics on text encoding, on image recognition, on provenance, quite a few of them. And what we try to do is gather the PowerPoint presentations or articles or written presentations that come from these seminars and record them all together in one place on the CERL website so that they form a lasting resource. And the next event is the CERL annual general meeting, to which you are all warmly invited. We're going to explore the topic of library history. Why should we study it? What should we study in that respect, and how should we tackle it? And it's going to be quite an interesting event because we're going to invite academics to give their perspective on library history, which I'm sure is very different from our librarian approach. I've mentioned the CERL website a few times, and it is actually a very rich website where we record as much information as we can bring together and try to keep it up to date. Much on biographical data, as you can see here, but also information and linking to watermarks. Schirmeier was mentioned earlier on book bindings. Well, they're his collection of dummies, so he made lots of examples of how bindings would look, what they would look like in practice, and they're about this size. There's a very nice display in the KB The Hague of his box, as it's called. So information about book bindings on the website, about printer's devices, and the latest... This screen is unbelievably small. Oh, these are former owners, so there's lots of provenance information on our website. And here the latest is edition, and you will have already seen some of their pictures that I was allowed to use in this presentation about the prices of incunables. And this is an interesting project because it's actually looking at the price of incunables throughout the centuries. So for how much money was an incunable bought in the 16th century, how much did a book command, what price did it command in the 17th century, and so on. This is a list, a very lively slide, and I'm not going to go through all of them, but it's to show the connections that CERL has across Europe and across organisations. These are some of the organisations that we are very happy to work with, some of them in projects, some of them in single projects. For example, Trame is working with us in Sundari project, and Trame has brought together lots of information on shelf marks, and focuses on manuscripts, lots of information on shelf marks and other ontologies. Liber, well, here, Europeana we've linked to, but we're also working with Europeana in the Europeana Cloud project, which is at the top middle. And ProQuest, Flams, Erfurt, Bibliotheca is a very interesting national group in Belgium who are doing much of the work that we're doing, but then on the national level, and actually some of the work that we should be doing on an international level, but we haven't started to do it yet. So we're always keeping a close eye on what they're up to next. IFLA has published very important guidelines on the digitization of rare books that we are warmly supporting. OCLC Rare Books Manuscript section in the US has very valuable information on its own website that we either link to or we talk to them about. Transcript Forum just had a very interesting presentation this morning about how it is actually looking at OCRing handwritten text. So there's a lot to try and keep track of, and what we try to do within the consortium is find the most important elements and ensure that our members are made aware of these initiatives. The top three are Sundari, Urbiana Cloud and Marie Curie. These are logos for projects that we are involved in. The Sundari project is looking at creating a virtual learning environment for historians, and this project is testing that notion on two sets of people, medievalists and World War I historians. It's looking at creating a collaborative environment where professors can work with their students, but you can also record your own research material and have some nifty tools like name entity recognition to support and make life a lot easier. Urbiana Cloud is creating a cloud infrastructure for cultural heritage material, but their own database, so they're starting with the Urbiana data, the data of the European Library and the Poznan supercomputing service, but this is meant to stay in place for all of us, so we can use that cloud infrastructure to store our data and make it on the principle of publish it once, use it several times, and that's more or less the aim of this cloud project. And the second part of that project is looking at creating an environment where academics can reuse Urbiana data or our data once it's in the cloud in a more structured manner. The last logo on my side on the right is the Marie Curie logo. This is to indicate that in February next year, one of the CERL colleagues is going to start on a project looking at 16th century popular culture, popular literature, most of it at the Rich Library, where she's going to be based, and she's going to look at describing that literature better and to place it in the context. There was room on the slide. So it isn't just that we are looking at organisations, larger conglomerates of people who have, or pots of money for that matter. We work with all of our CERL members, and we would like to work with very, very many more institutions, be they large or small. So that could be you. And then our staff. Considering that we're going to be released from this room at some point, then we will have a glass of wine waiting for us. You might want to talk to one or more of us during the reception. So I thought I'd introduce some of them to you. The middle picture, the four people in yellow, are from the left to the right, the CERL chairman of Girls On, and he's sitting here. And me, you can talk to me anytime. Then the organizer of today's event, Ingeborg Versprillen, who's sitting there, and Christina Donny, who was there this morning, I think for part of the sessions, but can't be here this afternoon. Then we have two offices. CERL has an office in London, and currently we have a colleague there called Kathleen Walker-Meekler, who's sitting there and is pictured there. And in Ingeborg, in the office with Ingeborg and me is Stefan Rossum, who's sitting there. And both of those are working on the Sundari project. And they're looking a bit embarrassed because I didn't tell them about this. Bottom left is Claudia Fabian, who's from the Bayerische Staatsbibliothek, but very importantly, the chairman of the LIBE Forum for Digital Cultural Heritage and a member of the coordinating committee in CERL. Then here is the true chairman of the security network, Christian Jensen of the British Library. Next to him in red is Ivan Bozorup, who is the chairman of the manuscript expert group. In the middle, Per, you've seen. Next to him is Raymond Berard. He is our treasurer, and I thought he was going to be in London, but unfortunately he had to send his apologies. And Adrian, you've seen. And the reason why Adrian is in that picture is not because he's so admirably chaired this afternoon session, but also because he's the chairman of our working group on promotion and dissemination. So, well, back to the cooking workshop. So fingers in pies, yeah. When I devised this title, I thought it's true to a certain extent, but actually it is much more a spider in a web. It's much more about coordinating, about getting people to talk, about sharing information, about making sure that you tie the right rope or spider's thread to the right piece in the web. And that is, I think, what we're trying to do very hard and very enjoyable. And it's so nice when occasionally it comes together. This is the next is a picture of a workshop where I wasn't present, so I didn't orchestrate this. This was sent to me by somebody who attended that workshop. And she said that there was, in February 2015, there was a workshop on scientific questions about provenance and their requirements for future web and database. And basically, it identified a need for authority files and persistent identifiers, but it also very much showed how so many of the elements of the stuff that we are working on, be it metadata, be it digitization, be it connecting elements of our knowledge, they can and they do actually come together in CERL, and that's what we're trying to do. And if we can help you with that, and if we can continue to do that, then we will be very happy to.
Humanities, manuscript studies, and paleography. Her research broadly covers medieval science and medicine and focused on the relationship between animals and humans in medieval history. She's previously worked at St. Louis University in the States, at the University of York, University College Cork in Ireland, and here in London at the Centre for the History of Medicine at UCL. So Kathleen's been working on the Centauri project since March, where she's responsible for archival resources guides and developing teaching materials for the project's virtual research environment. And it's this work on the Centauri project that's the subject of her paper this afternoon.
Hello, this thing where mine is. If you've had enough, and also sort of shelter if you can't hear me, if I'm speaking too fast, too slow, or as you can always show your sort of disdain just by walking out, I'll understand. like sheep. To start with, this is going to be a paper with lots of acronyms, so just warning you. But you're going to start because I work for CERL, this is the Sendavi project, and they all actually mean things. Basically, Sendavi is the collaborative European digital archive infrastructure. It's a 4-year European Commission-funded project made with 14 partners from across Europe. The objective is to integrate digital archives and resources in a virtual research environment. And at the moment, they are just specializing on medieval and World War I history. Those are almost two case studies. And so we're going to create a platform, the virtual research environment, the VRE, see I warn you, and this will allow scholars to access historical resources across institutional and national boundaries. In a very small aside, and Sendavi does this as well, and it'll probably make lots of you very angry, which is to generally use the word archives and archival material to mean everything, whether it's from archives, libraries, museums, other institutions, and archival material to be a very general term referring to almost all primary historical sources. So, just if any of you are archivists or librarians, please don't throw tomatoes at me just yet. The other thing to warn you is that it's very much work in progress, things are being developed, and so if sort of it looks like I sometimes will tell you about things that will be available soon and other things are available now. So the core of the Sendavi is the VRE is what's called the note-taking environment, the NTE, and it, along with an archival directory, more later, will have a search functionality in which there'll be standard, faceted, and semantic searching, and it will allow users, and these for this, and Ari's looking at mainly historians, but also archivists, librarians, and anybody else interested, where they can create their own notes of archival material and resources, they can upload documents, and so on. So they can also compile and comment on sources from the archival directory. They'll also be able to submit any text, files, or images to named entity recognition, which if we have time, we might try to do a demo. And so this way, the documents can be annotated semantically and connected with controlled vocabularies and ontologies. And Sindari will also be supplying two integrated ontologies for currently on the two test cases of Middle Ages and World War I. And it's also going to be linked to Trame, which Marianne mentioned, which is a big sort of big research infrastructure of databases on medieval manuscripts. And users also can order their compilations, make lots of notes, put projects together, separate projects, and they can also share and export the project. And here, this is a slide. Cinder, this is how partly it might look in the future. The previous slide showed how it currently looks, but here you can see where a user has been able to import a archival document. There's a little window above in which they could transcribe if they wanted, perhaps write notes about the document, or even perhaps put links to where they got that digitized source. And to introduce the NTE, the note-taking environment, to new users and to promote scholarly collaboration, Sindari is at this moment creating 25 freely accessible archive research guides, and 23 of those will be on medieval and World War I subjects, and two of them will be methodological, those two I'm creating. And they're very much aimed at scholars who are starting research on a certain topic, and will assist them in finding suitable documents. And also, users can annotate the existing archival research guides along with creating their own material. And the word archive research guide, it's taken from the idea of a traditional archival guide that is usually limited on one collection, but the Sindari archive research guides very much have one topic, but try to then look at this topic in a transnational way, or also perhaps possibly using the archive collections from many different countries. They're created by different researchers that are associated with the project, and they're very much connected to these researchers' own expertise. And they enable digital access to both archival holdings and content that's in the archival directory, as I said more later, as well as access to collections that are not in the directory itself, that is external ones. And different methodologies were used in their creation, but the aim is that they're going to do a starting point. They're not the core of Sindari, but the idea that you could that users can use them to introduce them to how does the system work. For example, on the right-hand side, you can see visualization of named entities, where you can have geographical places on a map, common places, names, dates, and so on. And for example, in this one, which is on parallel with records in Poland, you can see in the next slide how here all the archival material that's mentioned in this guide, it's got a very wide geographical dispersion. And so the named entity recognition, which, as I said, hopefully we can show you later, the idea of that is that it will enable the NTE to automatically identify relevant entries within the collections and within the material that you've uploaded or written down. And named entities for this case are relevant people, organizations, places, dates, events, or artifacts. And you'll be able to, in the virtual research environment, you can tag entities both manually and automatically, and they'll be then recognized in your notes as you do it. And so you can also create subnotes. So this is a, no, sorry, this is not a subnote. This is just more where there's text and links. So you can browse it, create, and with subnotes, that's an example of a subnote that then has lists of archival resources and links to the following. So it's a sort of an example of how you can create your own notes, because as I showed before, you can also upload material, but if you actually want to create notes in, and because it's all user focused, you can really write anything you like. You can publish it if you want it open to all, but you could also just share it privately with other named users. And this way, the aim of the current guides that have been created is just to present a large section, a selection of primary sources, so users can get an idea of how they might want to use this resource. And the other idea is that you can link your projects to guides that these guides themselves you can link your projects to, and you can also create your own. Other people can link to your projects, and with this way, create research communities in which users can compare archival notes and material that they've been uploading and collaborate. And they can, and also to almost all these material, for example, these guides, you can add archival holdings, relevant materials, and other notes, and you can also just upgrade content if you think it needs upgrading. And here you can, from the previous one, which you saw there, which is the first reference, it then links directly to the Sindari archival directory that has all information about the archival content in question. And another purpose of the VRE is that it can be used as a teaching tool for students, particularly undergraduates. A lecturer could present the notes and as a way in which the students can find digitized archival resources and also use it as a platform for collaborative scholarly work. Also, students, each with their own account, can share resources, have references to relevant archives and libraries, and also contextualize these archival resources. And apart from linking to archival sources in our archival directory, which is quite small at the moment, it sort of has quite a lot of entries, but seems small. But it's very much focused on entries that were created by those that were making these 25 archival research guides. But apart from those, you can also link to archival sources in external sites. So, for example, here under France, you can then link to the Bibliothèque de Documentation Internationale Contemporaine. So. And they things at the yes you'll see so there's yes medieval and World War I ones. So apart from these guides, which are really the aim is to introduce, as I said, our user to how to use the VRE. All users can create their own notes, upload documents, and do as they will. And the idea is to show these archive research guides as a model of a way of how you might want to organise research findings, or you might be helpful to organise archival collections that you've been using or plan to use, and there really are no restrictions on the kind of material you want to upload or write into these notes. And finally, the archival directory itself, it's a large database of archival collections that will be integrated into the VRE. And with it, a user can search and browse through collections and smaller local archives that have been underused by researchers. And that's actually one of the main aims of Sindari, is to link and try to find institutions that have either a very small web presence or almost no digitized content, or just quite unknown, perhaps due to a variety of reasons. So there's quite a lot of focus on archives in both Eastern and Southeastern Europe in the archival directory, and a lot of the content is, there was an aim to try to go and add as many things as possible, but in the end there was a realization that could not be comprehensive. So it's very much based on the two themes of World War I and the Middle Ages. And yes, the archival directory is created using Atom, which some of you might know. It's a web-based open source application that you can use to create your own database for archival descriptions. And the good thing about it is that it's standard to have in Atom. It has compliance with international archival standards, so it's quite easy to sort that out. That's just on data sets that we're using in Sindari. And a geographical representation of currently all of the archival institutions whose collections are mentioned in the archival directory. And the archival directory, it'll form Sindari's backbone in which digital content can be integrated. And one important thing about it is that users can add their own materials. They can add their own archival descriptions. Depending on their status, this is whether you actually have contributor rights or editor's rights, you can also add archival collections. But if you don't have the right sort of rights, it's quite easy to find someone who will perhaps revise your work. And they'll also, to make sure that once you've added you added your own archival description, or perhaps corrected or added to an existing note, that there will be someone who will go and check and revise this before it's then published to the public. And similarly with the virtual research environment, you can't go around sort of editing everything and it automatically will appear to the public. There will be a system where it will be checked first, and that's just to avoid deleting everybody else's work, which would be very sad. So here's very quick, which since it's on the screen, I will not go into much of selection criteria for the archives that are selected to exist in the archive directory. And you can see for World War I, it was all countries that were in World War I, and also actually those that in which geographically it was fought. So for example, archives in Kenya. And special attention, yes, given to Eastern and Southeast Europe, and archival institutions with important holdings, and also archives that have a large amount of digitization of contents. And similarly for medieval culture, the selection criteria was to include archives in most Western countries. Again, special attention to Eastern and Southeastern Europe. Collections that appear a lot in scholarly bibliography, and again, archives that have digitized a large part of their collection. There's also a case of the willingness of archival institutions to cooperate and be happy to provide content, which in some cases also limits what's going on. And again, there's an interest also in what Sindari were calling hidden archives, which are those that don't have any digital representation and also lack the means currently to digitize their material or provide any digital finding aids. So the archive directory tries to help them. And I think, as I said, to limit it, that it plans to describe between 600 and 800 collections for the modern period and about 250-500 for the medieval period. And so, yes, currently users who have accounts, at the moment this is with Daria, they can read, create, or edit archival descriptions in the archival directory. However, you can't delete anything or create a new record without editorial help. And it is noted that archival descriptions should be added when you're observing International Council on Archive Standards, and we provide links to this and so on. Also want to more on the sort of archival institutions and also an entry for an archival institution. So yes, because users can upload material, the archival directory can be seen as a work in progress. At the moment, a lot of the material was uploaded by people who were working on the archival search guides, but it's because anybody can upload material, it can become more general, therefore it's not just a project focused on World War I and the Middle Ages, it would be of any historic discipline. And again, it's not the only way in which you can link your material to the virtual research environment. You can also do that externally. And on a small thing, oh, that's just a note that you can do faceted searching in the archival directory and limit it by subjects, by places, languages, and so on. However, for subjects and places, we do note that because many people who submit descriptions don't actually put, for example, a subject, it's a case we tell users not to use that as the sole way of searching for your items, and often to do a sort of a general keyword search might be more helpful. And users, as they can add descriptions, but if they wish to publish their archival descriptions and their search results from Sendari, they would need to discuss relevant permissions with the archive in question, because Sendari does not have specific agreements with all of these archival institutions. So you could use this material to go on and find your archival material, but the idea is that you are not cannot then automatically publish and use everything if you're taking it from their own site. And on that quick note, we're going to sort of do a very quick demo in which Stein, my colleague, is just going to quickly turn this off or sort of see if we can put it on. We're going to just show you how the named entity recognition system works. I think for time, since I show you slides of the archive research, the NTE and the archival directory, we'll just work on this.
Okay, it seems to be working. We had some problems today.
We also had problems with the VRE, which is why I'm very glad that we had PowerPoint slides, since it was the classic problem of if I'd been trying to do this every on the time, it would be difficult.
So just to really show you how it might work and also where maybe the problems are still today, you can, when you're in the NTE, the notating environment, you could upload any text you would like, then push a button, as I will do now, and the system should recognize quite a number of entities automatically. And then if something's wrong, you can change them manually. But the system can find most of them automatically. Currently, it's only working for English. They're trying to make it work for a number of other languages. And they will try to reach state-of-the-art, the point of state-of-the-art, where it has like 91% of accuracy. So this links to, for the moment, to Wikipedia pages and also Freebase pages, but in the future there will be more things linked to it. So you can see it recognizes places, times, also different kinds of battles and persons, as is seen here. So, yeah, in the future this will work automatically if you would like. As you can see, just to say that it's not perfect, that you can see, for example, the battles here. It recognizes this battle, but it fails to recognize this one, where it's only the town. So for this kind of errors, there are things to be improved. We are looking for people who want to work with us in testing the Sendari project. So if you're interested in working together and knowing how things work, there are bookmarks we put out, or you can go just to the website, the Sendari website, and sign up to join the Trusted Users group. It's quite fun, you know, we use Basecamp, we have webcasts, there is information, there's videos we put out to meet and discuss things that could be improved. So we're at the very point of putting all the elements together. And so this is a very critical moment to test and to see what is working, what is not working, and also, since it's going to be meant for users, how you would like to see things organized, what you like, what you don't like. It's really the moment to speak up and tell us what you mean.
Tell us your mind.
Absolutely.
Just
okay.
Yes, that's fine. So yes, thank you very much, Stein. Yes, one of the demons in the picture. I think that's the multiple representation of all the staff of CERL. Better that than using our own photo as well. To conclude, Sendari aims to create this powerful tool that will underpin an interactive search environment. So with this platform, you can have centralized online access to assorted European resources, particularly digital archives and collections. You can integrate disparate sources, and with this transnational and comparative approach, you can upload material, write notes in however you like them. It'll have the named entity recognition service in which that can go through first any text you write, but also any text you upload once we have more language problems sorted out. So the search functions will be multilingual. There'll be indexes of all the named entities, and the entire platform is very much personalized for the user, but they can also share their research. And also, depending on what they do, it can also be used to create a teaching space. There's also data visualization, as I sort of was showing before, in which data can all be visualized in a variety of ways. And to do this, and to help us design a tool that meets researcher needs, we're creating a feedback loop with potential users, and this is our trusted user group, in which I have here on the slide some of the fun things you can do if you join our trusted user group, or our TUG as we call you. And you can see it's not overly arduous. We'll only hassle you once a month, and you just have to come to, if you can, to a 1-hour webcast. But we also provide videos, training documentation, and you don't have to come to every single release if you can't, like, because you can still have a look at the videos and the documentation if you can't come to the webcast. But we're very keen to get feedback, so please join if you want to. Apart from the bookmarks, which we have upstairs, which are very jolly, you can also contact both Stein and I. And there's also outreach workshops and expert seminars, which we at CERL were going to be organizing in The Hague in October. And there's also assorted other training programs, such as a summer school, which is going to be held in about 3 weeks' time in Prague on Humanities and Middle Ages, and they're also visiting researcher fellowships, which I can say you can no longer apply because it's the last year. So on that cheerful note of Sendari work in progress, but hopefully you can create this entire platform for you to be able to do as much as possible archive-wise. And on that note, I will let you breathe or run away or get wine.
That brings us to the end of this afternoon's events. What we'll try and do is we'll get some of the PowerPoint presentations on the CERL website, so you should be able to follow through there and take notes. Thank you to Ingeborg for organising all of today's meetings and this afternoon's event. And thank you to Nicholas of the University of the Arts for hosting us today. We're very pleased to have been here. We've got to make our way over to the green room, where we have wine. An opportunity for you to corner each of today's presenters or indeed members of the CERL committee and executive. But finally, before we go, can I ask you to come together and thank our speakers, Nicholas Bickwood, Carrie Hillhead, Marion Lefferts, and Kathleen Walker-Beaker. Thank you.
Thank you.
have to take.